The last lecture we discussed about the introductory parts, like what are the contents of the module 4. Apart from that, we also discussed how to use the platform. I think most of you have already got into my Google Classroom platform. Now let us get into the module 4, which is about electric and magnetic field in material space. First of all, let us see the electric field only, means electric field in material space. Till now, we were discussing about electric and magnetic field in free space, or whenever your permittivity and permeability values we use as epsilon 0 or mu 0. What happens to field when it comes to a material space? So getting into the classification of materials, we have three classification: conductors, insulators and dielectrics. These are classified based on the value of conductivity, sigma, which is measured in Siemens per meter. Whenever the conductivity, electrical conductivity, is greater, very much greater than 1, such materials we call as conductors, and examples are metals. And whenever it is very much lesser than 1, then we call such materials as dielectrics. And for semiconductors, the conductivity value comes between the in between the values for conductors and insulators. These are if you take an example, let us take a wire. In a wire, the copper is the conducting part, which is having very high conductivity for electrical current. So that is the copper is the conducting part, and whenever you that current carrying conductor, if you want to hold on your hand without getting electric shock, you have an insulator surrounded by it. That insulator might be PVC or any other material, so that which does not allow the flow of current to you. So that is an example for insulator, and you have semiconductors as well. The main difference in this metals or conductors and insulators is that metals will have abundant number of free electrons for conduction. As when you see insulator, they will have very less free electrons for current conduction. So that is the major difference, and that is why their conductivity value differs. The typical conductivity value for conductors will come to 10^7 Siemens per meter. When it is for semiconductors, it will be in between that for the value for insulator and conductor. Here it is given here 10^0 to 10^-4, and we call something an insulator whenever its conductivity is somewhat lesser than 10^-4 Siemens per meter. While dealing with the first modules, whenever we were dealing with electrostatics, then that time the one quantity we knew was voltage. So in electrical engineering, the fundamental quantities, they are always voltage and current. We deduct all other quantities in electrical engineering based on these two quantities, voltage and current. Voltage or potential difference is already dealt in the first module. Let us focus on current in this module. So now let us get into current and current density. So what is current? Current is caused by the flow of charges in a material. This is known to you. This current is caused by the flow of charges in a material. You apply a potential difference, you establish an electric field, and because of that, charge will flow in a material. That is what is meant by current. So when we want to quantify it, we may define it as the current in ampere through an area. It means whenever we are talking about the current, then we should specify an area. It means through an area, it is given by the electric charge passing through that area in unit time. It means the rate of flow of charge. That is what is meant by current through a particular area. Whenever your area cross section changes, definitely current will change. So I is given by dq divided by dt. No, correct. So what it is meant is that when we say current of 1 ampere is flowing, what we are meaning is that through some area S, let us say a current of 1 ampere is flowing, if I say, it means that through that area really 1 coulomb of charge is being transferred per second. That is what is meant by 1 ampere of current. So let me say, if I say delta I is the current that which is flowing through a planar surface, delta S, not just this complete surface, let us say a small area. Even if you take this surface, let us say in that also a small area I am considering, and that I am calling as delta S. Delta Yes. Then in that small area, whatever will be the current flowing is delta I. Then let us define the next term, which is the current density. Current density means it is the current flowing per unit area, or J is defined as delta I divided by delta S. The current J or the current density is defined as the current going through unit area. Now, clear? So J is given by delta I divided by delta S. Then we can rewrite the same equation as delta I equal to J into delta S. Means the total current flowing will be equal to current density into whatever surface area that we have considered. So that way we can rearrange the equation. So this is when this particular equation is valid when we are considering that current is normal to the surface. When we consider current is normal to the surface, this is true. Like current is your current density as well as your delta S is in the same direction, then it is true. Then but that will not be the case always. Like if you take a surface S and this is my surface S, and the direction of delta S, direction of S as well as the direction of current, whenever they are the same, then this equation is valid, delta I equal to J delta S. If it is not, we can represent the general case as the dot product. This is known from your 1, 2, 3 module. So whenever your area is a bit tilted, then we can take the projection using the dot product, or delta I we can be given as J dot delta S. We will take the dot product between current density and the surface. So the total current flowing, this is through a small area. If you have a small big surface, first we are considering about the small surface, which is the delta S. When we have to when we want to find out the total current flowing through the whole surface and S, then we can write the current as the total current as the surface integral over J dot ds, the dot product of J dot ds over the surface integral over S. So that is how we find out the total current flowing through the surface. So basically, this current also, depending on the material whichever it is flowing, or based on how the current is produced, the current density is also getting classified, or current or current density, both are getting classified. There are three types of current or current densities. One is called convection current density, another one is conduction current density. This is what we are going to deal first, and there is another thing called as displacement current density. This is something that we will deal with dielectrics or with polarization. So that will come into picture when we are thinking about the insulators or the dielectrics part. But first let us see in conductors. So in normal conduction methods are convection current as well as conduction current. First let us see what is meant by convection current. This type of current happens whenever current is flowing through an insulating medium, basically like a liquid, rarefied gas or vacuum. Let us consider we have a vacuum filament or somewhere where your electrons are flowing through vacuum. So this figure here, please see this figure. So in this figure, you are seeing this tube where let me say current is flowing, or the charges are in motion. The density of charge, whichever is flowing, that is given by rho v. Delta S is the surface cross the area of cross section normal to which your charges are flowing, and delta Y is the displacement, let me say, or the small displacement happening per unit time, and U is the velocity of the charge carriers. U is the velocity of the charge carriers. Now charge density is rho V, and U is as we have seen, vector U is U Y A Y, because here we are using the Cartesian coordinate system where the U is in the direction of Y, or it is in the Y direction. So we can represent it as U Y into A Y cap, since it is in the Y direction only, or it is having only Y directional component. So now the current is given by what? Current, the small the current delta I, whichever is happening through this delta S area, we can write it as delta Q divided by delta T. Now what is delta Q? Delta Q means the total charge which is moving in unit time. So in order to find out delta Q, whenever it is moving delta Y displacement through this delta S surface area, Let us say that the total volume will be equal to what? Delta S into delta Y. That is what we are getting here. Delta S into delta Y means that is the total volume. The charge is able to move unit time. So into the charge density will give you the total charge whichever is crossing this delta S surface in unit time. So we can write delta Q as rho V delta S delta Y divided by delta T. So here this delta Y by delta T means that is the small change in distance in Y direction divided by the small time required for that. So delta Y by delta T is basically the velocity of the particle. So we can write it here as rho V into delta S U Y. Delta Y by delta T can be substituted as U Y or the velocity of the moving charge. So we can write it as rho V into delta S in Y. So basically here we were dealing with the current density. So current density at a given point is the current through unit normal area at that point. Right, current through unit area at that point. In terms of convection current also, here the current is flowing through this delta S. So whatever delta I is flowing, or whatever be the current, small current is flowing, divided by delta S will give you the current density. Here, since the current also, since the particles are moving with u velocity in the y direction, definitely it implies that current also is moving in the same direction, or the vector J, current density vector, also we can represent similar way in the y direction. So vector J is given by JY into a y cap. So JY means what? The current density in y direction, which is equal to delta I divided by delta S. The current, small current passing through that area, delta S divided by delta S. So delta I divided by delta S. So what is delta I? The last slide we already found out delta I as rho V into delta S into U Y and divided by delta S. So delta S and delta S we can cut off, and that is how we get J Y as rho V into U Y. Rho V means what? The charge density, and U Y is the velocity of the moving particle. This is applicable everywhere, not only in case of convection current. So in general, what we can write is that the vector J we can write as rho V into vector U. So that will be the current density. Current density in general we can write as rho, the charge density into velocity. Current density can be written as charge density into velocity. This is an important point to be noted. Till now, we have seen the convection current. Now let us get into conduction current. Whatever is happening in the normal conductors that we use, like copper or aluminium or iron, or all type of conductors, how the conduction processes happen. And then the main difference in conductors and insulators is that, as you know, they are having free electrons. Free electrons in the sense they have an overlapped valence band and conduction band normally in metals. So under normal condition, these electrons will be revolving around atoms, or they will be in constant motion, but they will not have a particular direction of motion. The net velocity will be zero. Whenever we apply a particular electric field, as shown in the figure now, I am applying a positive plate on one side and negative plate on the other side. So because of this positive plate and positive plate kept here, the electrons will start drifting in the direction of this positive plate or away from the negative plate. This is the normal characteristic. Like a force is applied on it due to the electric field which is created due to the applied potential difference. So let me say electric field is applied in this way, like this. So that is how current is produced in a normal material. So whenever they move, they are getting drifted. Whenever they move, they will get drifted in one direction. And in the metal lattice, it is not only electrons, there are ions also. Means apart from this electron, there are the ions or the with the nucleus and all present here. So because of that, they will have collisions also, or they will have some damping in the motion. So this which is the cause for resistance and all, which we will come afterwards. So because of this electric field, the charges will start experiencing a force because of which they are moving. So that force, so means whenever we are applying this electric field E here, and all or this charge of one electron is given by E. The small letter E, it is equal to 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 coulombs. You already know. So due to this charge, whenever you are placing a charge in an electric field, that is experiencing a force F equal to minus E. So this is the force on a single electron. Similarly, the same force is applied on all electrons, which is causing this drift. So normally, as you can see here, the electrons are moving from left to right. But here we say our conventional current. The conventional current will be flowing from right to left, means in the opposite direction of flow of this electrons. We say that way. So the electron suffers constant collision with the atomic lattice on the way, and according to Newton's law, means there will be change in velocity and all. This part you already learned in material science, so I am avoiding some part. So according to Newton's law, we already know, our understanding on force is that when we say there is a rate of change of momentum, then which will be equal to the force. So whenever they are having collisions and all, if I consider u is the average velocity of electron in the metal lattice, and tau is the time between two successive collisions, then we can say that the rate of change of momentum, means mu divided by t, which is equal to the electrostatic, which is equal to the electric force, means minus E into E. So that is what we can obtain here. So from if we can reconstruct that, then we will get that the velocity u will be equal to minus E tau by m into E. This E tau by m, these are all constants. E is the charge of electron, and m also is the mass of electron, which is again 9.1 into 10 power minus 31 kilogram. And tau is also a constant. So what it implies is that the drift velocity u, the drift velocity of electron u, is proportional to the electric field. We call this quantity eta by m as the mobility and all. So now let us consider, this is about one electron alone. Now let us consider if there are n electrons per unit volume, then we can say the volume charge density in the conductor is rho v equal to minus n e. Minus is given because the electric charge also is the charge of an electron is negative, so minus n. You can see the same in all other equations. So from that, in the convection current, I already told you that current density will be equal to charge density into velocity. Here it is the drift velocity. So in the place of drift velocity, use the minus e tau by m e substitution, and in terms of the rho v, we can use minus n e. From there we get that j will be equal to n e square tau by m into e. If you can if you want, you can check that by substituting these two equations, then you will find that conduction current density equal to n e square tau by m into e. This current density is proportional to electric field. Here the quantity n e square tau by m into e, that is equal to sigma, or the conductivity of the conductor. J equal to sigma E. This is not known to you, and particularly since current density is defined at a particular point, this formula we call as Ohm's law in point form. J equal to sigma E is usually referred to as Ohm's law in point form. So that is our conclusion from here. The Ohm's law in point form is expressed as J equal to sigma times the electric field intensity. Now let us see what happens in conductors when we are applying an electric field. Particularly here, the conductor is isolated. So this blue box, let me say it's a conductor, and it is under the presence of an electric field. Means electric field is applied. So basically this conductor surface, not the surface, the conductor material, they are having free electrons, means positive and negative charges, which are ready to get moved. So under that circumstance, what happens is that the charges first will migrate as positive and negative charges to both sides. Means as per the direction of this electric field, it is represented here as E suffix E, or this EE means the external electric field that we are applying. Because of that, inside the material, the charges will move to two direction. Positive charge will come toward in the direction of the electric field and negative charge in the opposite direction. So that is the first thing that will happen. Hence, when this form a layer of charge on the both sides of the conductor. Because of that, we will have a electric field. Means whenever we have positive and negative charges on two sides, that means that we have an electric field between that two layers. So this positive and negative charge layer, they are sufficient to produce an electric field inside the material. EI in the opposite direction to the external applied electric field, because here positive and negative are in the reverse manner. So whenever you apply an electric field to a conductor, two types of fields are formed. One is the external electric field whichever we applied, and due to that we have a charge layer on both sides of the conductor, which will create an internal electric field represented in the yellow color here. So because of that, what happens is that inside the material, this external electric field and internal electric field, they will cancel each other. So under electric field E, positive and negative charges are pushed on the same and opposite direction as already discussed. And because of that, two mechanisms or two things, what happens is that this charges will first accumulate as we have seen, positive and negative will get accumulated on the surface, forming an induced surface charge. They are induced because of the externally applied field. Once that happens, and that's a quick process. Once that happens, what happens is that this induced charges will set up an induced internal electric field. So this EI, which will cancel the externally applied electric field. So in the second figure, as you can see here, in the second figure, inside the conductor, outside there is external electric field, but inside the conductor, since the internal and external fields got cancelled, we have electric field equal to zero. So our electric field will become zero inside a conductor. This is provided when your conductivity is very high. So whenever very high means what? A perfect conductor means the conductivity is infinity. So whenever we say a perfect conductor, it cannot contain any electrostatic field within it. We exploit this property very much in our application. So whenever we have a perfect conductor or conductivity is infinity, then it will not contain any electrostatic field within it. Since the conductivity is infinity, whenever we apply an external electric field, that instant itself the charges were able to move freely and forming this induced charge layer on the two sides. So once they got established, the field will get the internal field will occur first, they will get cancelled, so that the net electric field inside a material is zero. This is a very important point. So that we know that now we know that the electric field intensity is zero inside a material. No doubt on that. So similarly, we have defined electric field as the negative gradient of potential. Whenever we say that electric field is C, the gradient of potential also should be zero. Gradient of potential means what? That means that the potential between two points inside the conductor should be, the potential difference between two points inside the conductor should be equal to zero, or there is no potential difference inside the conductor. Clear? So a conductor we can consider as an equipotential body, VAB equal to zero. If we take two points A and B anywhere inside the conductor, then it will be zero. So we already have known that J is what? Current density is equal to conductivity into electric field density. We can see the same thing in another way. Means when we say current density should be a finite quantity, even depending on the material also. Whatever electric field we apply based on the conductivity, the current density should be a finite value. So whenever we have a perfect conductor, it means that in this equation sigma is going towards infinity. Whenever sigma is going towards infinity, in order to make the J finite, definitely our electric field should come to zero, or should come nearby zero. So That way also we can understand the fact that whenever your conductivity of the material is going very much high, similarly the electric field intensity inside the material will come very much close to zero. So that is another way of understanding. And one more thing I want to tell here is about the volume charge density inside a conductor. So under the application of an electric field. We have already learned that in point form, Gauss's law can be represented as del dot D equal to rho V. So we know that D, the electric flux density, is equal to epsilon times electric field density. So whenever I say that electric field intensity is zero or E is zero, that implies that del dot, whenever D is zero, for del dot D to be zero, the rho V should also be equal to zero. So these are the two conditions for a conductor in an electric field. So we can conclude here that inside a conductor under the application of an external electric field, then our electric field intensity is zero. Then the second point is what? The volume charge density is also zero. And with that, the third point is that potential difference between any two points also is zero, which implies that a conductor is an equipotential body. So, till now we were discussing about electric field density inside a conductor. We know that the electric field density will be zero. Now, I want to take you to a similar situation here. As you are seeing in this figure, you have a conducting material in this blue line, means it's a conductor, and blue line, and here you are connecting it to a potential source or a EMF source, which is having a potential difference of V. So whenever it is connected, definitely charge is flowing inside and we have an electric field density inside it. So in the last slide, we have seen that inside a conductor, electric field will be zero. So now interesting question here is that whether really in this case also electric field is zero or electric field is not equal to zero. What do you think? So the two cases are just similar, right? There also we have a conductor under an electric field. Here also we have a conductor supplied to a potential so that an electric field is induced and current is flowing. So inside conductor also there is electric field, right? So in this case, electric field is there. What is the basic difference? In the last case, there was no wire connected. Here, as you can see, there is wire connected on the two sides. The basic difference is in the connection or establishment here with this wire. And there is a potential electromotive force in order to make this current flow happen. That is the difference between last and this one. When we said the electric field is zero in a conductor, that is about a conductor which is isolated, and kept between, and there is no direct connection, or it is not wired. So whenever it is wired, it prevents the establishment of a static equilibrium, so that two charge kinds, means positive and negative charges, can go and be there on the two sides, establishing an internal electric field. That will never happen here. Whenever it is wired and we have a potential difference source or a source for electromotive force on the other side. So that is the difference. Here electric field is not equal to zero because it is wired. And the case I said before is for a conductor which is isolated from everything. And kept under electric field. Here we have an electromotive force source here, which is applying a potential difference and it is connected. So that every time this conduction is happening. So that is the difference. So whenever under this electric field, whenever the electrons move, our conduction current happens. And these electrons will encounter metal, that is ions, in between, so that they will be damping, or in different materials, depending on the atomic structure, there will be changes in the in how much better they can conduct. That is why silver is a better conductor than copper. So that difference comes based on the atomic structure, and that damping, that whatever damping happens, that we represent as the resistance of a material. So whenever we say something is having higher resistance, then the current flow, the electrons will experience more collisions in between the paths. So Here, the applied electric field due to this potential is E, as we have already rounded it out, that is E, and the length of the conductor is L. Then electric field, well, since our is surface area is uniform, means from this point to this point, since your surface area is not changing, then we can write electric field as V divided by L. Voltage per unit length is the electric field. In this particular case, when your surface area is uniform, we already know that current density is given by the total current divided by S. So if the I is the current flowing and S is the surface area, then current density is given by I divided by S. That is also equal to sigma E. So this sigma E in terms of the electric field density, we can substitute here V by L in this particular case, because you have a uniform surface area. So what is resistance? So this part we already got, that sigma V by L is the I by S. So we can write it as I by S equal to what? Sigma V by L. I by S is sigma V by L. What is meant by resistance? Resistance is always given by V divided by I. If we take the current from this side to this side and L to other end, rearrange it in terms of V by I, we get resistance as L divided by sigma S. It is just after rearrangement of this first equation. So we get resistance as L divided by sigma S. Sigma is the conductivity. There is another term called resistivity of a conducting material, rho C, defined here. Normally we know this equation, rho C L by A, S by L by S, where S is the surface area. This is already known to you. We are just taking it this way in here. So resistance is given by rho C into L by S. So this particular equation, as I already said, it is only when your surface area S is uniform all over the conductor. But in general terms, we can always represent R as V by I, right? In terms of Ohm's law, Ohm's law says that V proportional to I, or R is the proportionality constant. That is why we can represent resistance as always as V by I. So in any general case, means for any shape or under any circumstances, our potential is always given by line integral over E dot dl, right? E dot dl, and current is given by what? Current is J dot ds, right? Current we have represented as was J dot ds under the integral over surface S. J here we are representing as sigma E dot ds. So this is the term we normally use for resistance. This we will get into afterwards in the module. Okay, this particular equation. For now, we can just remember. Now, let us get into the last part. Since we are discussing about conductors, let us see power also. What is power? Power is everywhere it is the same. Power is the ability to do work, or power is defined as the rate of change of energy. Rate of change of energy, or you did some work, what is its rate? W divided by T. That gives you the power. What is the unit of power? And it can also be represented, if you remember your mechanics in first year and all, you can also represent power as force times velocity, right? So similarly here, the electrical power also can be seen the similar way. So what is force? Force means in electrical engineering, force means what? We have already seen for an electron, the force will be equal to E into the charge of the electron into the electric field density. Similarly here, charge into electric field density will give you what? The force. Here, the total charge, it is under some volume. So under any volume, if we know the charge density rho V, the total charge will be what? Rho V into dV. Rho V dV will be the total charge inside any volume. And whatever be the electric field applied on that charge, so that is E. Rho V dV into E will give you the total force and in the system of charges, right? Rho V dV into E. Then force times velocity. So that is why we are taking the dot product with the velocity vector U, right? If we rearrange it, since rho V is a constant, if we rearrange it this way, we can write it as E dot rho V into vector U dV. U is the velocity of charge, that is U dV. So here rho V into U is something you are already familiar in this lecture. The charge density into velocity will give you the charge density. That is why power can be represented as volume integral over v e dot j into dv. E dot j into dv. This is what we now call as Joule's law. And here let us see, this is the total power. Then what can we do for identifying the power density? Power density in a volume, that is given by power per volume or dp divided by dv. So this is the integral. Over this integral, if we apply differentiation, we will get power density as E dot j, right? Vector E dot vector j, that is the power density. This also needs to be remembered. E means electric field density and j means electric current density. Here j is again what? J is already given by sigma e. So if we apply if we substitute it for in place of j as sigma e, we will get that E dot sigma e. Since sigma is a constant, E dot e is nothing but e square. So we will get the power density as sigma e square. You have to please remember these terms. So for a conductor, and now let us take the last part, means what? For a conductor with uniform cross section, whatever we discussed in the last slides, a similar thing. Let us say there is a cylindrical type conductor and it is having a uniform cross section ds. Then in that case, we can just write the volume as ds into dl. dl means what? In whichever direction your field is applied or in whichever direction your current is flowing. So that direction is dl direction, ds into dl. So in that case, the power is what? E dot j dv. Whenever both of them are in the same direction, then we can write ej into dv. dv we can again substitute as ds and dl. Then that is here rewritten like this, over the integral over the line integral edl into integral over the surface integral jds. What is edl? E dot dl or edl? Edl, whenever it is the same direction. Edl means what? Edl is the potential. Right, it is the potential difference two points. Whenever you want to find out potential difference, is what? Integral over E dot dl. So that is what is potential. And the integral of the surface is j dot j ds is means what? That is the current density and the surface area. So whenever we integrate over the surface, we get the current. So this is what is our familiar equation that we always use. So power is given by V into I. This is what we apply in normally in our circuit theory, but it also can be proved from this electric field theory as well. So now we have discussed about the conductors mainly, and in conductors how the current flows. So let us summarize that. In summary, so first we have seen what is meant by current and what kinds of currents are there. So there is something called convection current and conduction current. And current is given by what? J dot ds, where j is the current density and I is the total current. And that we express again as what? Rho, the charge density into velocity of the charge. And from there we came into j equal to sigma e, or the Ohm's law in point form. Right? How it is getting related with the electric field density. How current or current density is related to electric field density is given by Ohm's law in point form of J equal to sigma e. Means it is conductivity times electric field density. Now conductor, whenever it is under an applied electric field, then if it is isolated, then we have electric field is zero inside a conductor. Rho V is zero and VAB also is what? Equal to zero. So that means, it means that inside a conductor there is no electric field density or there is no charge density. Even if we want to apply some more charge inside the material, whenever it is isolated and put under an electric field, what happens is that as per theory the electric field density should be zero. So the charge will come to the surface and redistribute itself so that the electric field density is zero. That is something I forgot to say. So that is the point about conductor under an applied electric field. Now we all also have seen what is meant by resistance in terms of field quantities, and at last we define power also in terms of field quantities. Clear? So with this we are completing this lecture. Now on the next lecture I will be dealing on polarization of in dielectrics. And before getting into next lecture, we will do I will try to post another video with some exercise, one or two exercise, and afterwards you can also practice some of the exercise. And as you already know that your module 1 test will be on 18, so prepare for that. Just learn everything practice problems and prepare for that. So hope you all would like this thing, and if you have some comment about how to conduct this lecture, please mail me, or you can send that on WhatsApp. Thank you.